word in our culture than following and friending, you know, whether it's Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, Pinterest, LinkedIn, you name it. We're somehow connected. It's meeting a great need in our culture, isn't it? That need for connection. Now, with that comes along the other side of it too. There's some of you who will just refuse and you will not embrace this movement. You prefer your flip phone. Or what was before the flip phone? I can't even remember. The cord connected to the wall. You guys have no idea what that's about. You've never seen one. And we don't know what the social repercussions are of this whole, you know, wireless connected, you know, we don't know what the results of that, because with everything good, there comes some things that are bad as well. I mean, that's a good thing. I like it. I like Facebook. I love to be connected and hear what's going on. I have to be careful, though, that it's not the first thing I run to in the morning before God. I have to be careful that I just don't, you know, become consumed in it. And it's, you know, so I have to be careful just like you. But, you know, you have to look, too, what does it mean about some of our relational habits and communication habits? What kind of effect is that going to have on just the simple idea of talking? You know, face-to-face talking. I mean, you can be at the holidays, which are sacred, right? And you can be sitting around after a great meal of turkey and kind of, you know, and waiting to have good conversation. And let's say there's 12 people in the living room. I guarantee 10 out of 12 will be like this, right? You know, we just lose the art of communication. We like to hide behind a keyboard. Some feel more comfortable that way now. What are the results of this whole movement? Again, I enjoy it, but we have to be careful too with this whole idea of following and the tweeting and the twexting. And I mean, yeah, there's such a thing. I mean, you know, what does it take away? It takes away from sometimes your sleep, because you are well aware of the midnight glow that happens, and you lose sleep because you just, you know, keep following and you keep doing this and you keep doing that. And, you know, sometimes we try to read between the lines. We get all emotional about somebody's post because we're, you know, maybe assuming something that we shouldn't be assuming. We lose brain rest. We lose that downtime. And we lose just the ability to think and to dream and to strategize about our own lives versus, you know, just kind of living vicariously through someone else. When we look at what Jesus talks about when he talks about following me, in fact, I want you to turn this morning to Mark chapter 1. We're going to look at a couple verses there, but specifically Mark chapter 17. And as you're turning, let me just mention this. You know that if Facebook was a nation in the world, it'd be the third largest nation in the world. China would be number one. India would be number two. Facebook would be the third largest nation. And then the United States of America. Justin Bieber has 40 million followers. Lady Gaga has 38 million followers. Katy Perry has 37 million followers. And our President Barack Obama has 32 million followers. Millions of followers. Do you know how many followers Jesus has? It's in the billions. 2.5 billion followers of Jesus. But what did Jesus really mean when he says in verse 17, look what he says right there, "Come, follow me," Jesus said, "and I will make you fishers of men." I think Jesus meant something completely different than we mean when we follow somebody. Because when we think of following somebody, we can hit the little tab that says "follow me," but what does it mean? He meant something completely different. When we follow somebody, it doesn't mean literally that you are going to follow them physically. I mean, that would really elevate the creeper status, wouldn't it? Stalking status. I mean, I can't even comment on one of my daughter's posts without them saying, "Dad, leave my friends alone," or leave, you know. So when you follow somebody, it doesn't mean you're following them around. When you friend somebody, it doesn't mean you're really their friend. You're just kind of what? You're kind of looking in. You're kind of reading a little bit about them. You don't even have to embrace or totally agree with what they're posting. You're just kind of looking in. Well, what did Jesus mean when he said, "Come and follow me"? I don't believe he was saying, just take a look in. But what he meant was to leave everything. And that's what they did back then. They left their house. They left their family. They left their job. They left their community. But that was understood back in that day. When you were a disciple of someone, an official disciple of someone, I'll explain that in just a minute, you left everything. Nowadays, we look at that and like, are you kidding me? Here this guy in his robe is walking along the Sea of Galilee and he starts saying, "Follow me." And what does it say? Look what it says. It says they left everything. They left their job. They left their families. They left their nets. They left everything. And they, how impractical is that today? What does it mean for us today? We'll talk about that in just a moment. But to understand the biblical idea of following, you need to understand what every Jewish boy and every family that wanted to educate their children went through, because there were three stages of education for we'll just use a Jewish boy, for example. Their education would begin at age 6 when they'd enter what's called Bet Sefer. And they would go to school, and they'd go to the synagogue. There wasn't an actual school. It was the synagogue. And a rabbi would teach them. And they only had one textbook. They didn't have a backpack full of books and all their little Sharpies and pens, all that kind of. They had one book, and it was the Old Testament, the first 5 books called the Torah. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. The first five books of the Bible. It was the Torah. That was their textbook. God's Word was central in the education of their children. And so they would be in this stage of Bet Sefer at age 6 till about 10 or 12, and it would be their job to memorize the first 5 books of the Old Testament. I mean, look how thick that is, to memorize the first 5 books. Wow. Now, they also would learn their family trade alongside that, because just in case they didn't do so well in school, they could always fall back on stone cutting, fishing, carpentry, or whatever trade the family had. But the best of the best would go on to the next level called Bet Talmud. And it's in Bet Talmud for the next several years, maybe till 14 and 15, that they would memorize the rest of the Old Testament, all the way from Genesis to Malachi. Think about that! And so they would memorize the entire Old Testament. And those that couldn't do that, by that time they were asked to go home and pick up the family trade, whatever they had been learning. But then the best of the best would go on to the next level. After Bet Sefer, after Bet Talmud, they'd get into Bet Midrash. And that's where, for maybe another 10 years, they would go to a rabbi and they would apply to become that rabbi's disciple. Now, they just didn't want to know about the rabbi. They wanted to be like the rabbi and do what the rabbi did. And each rabbi kind of did things a little bit differently. That's what's called midrashing, it's an interpretation of how to best live out the Torah. So, for instance, one rabbi, you know, would follow the law that says honor and keep the Sabbath holy. But, you know, when you keep it holy, you don't do any work. But they'd have different interpretations of what kind of how far could you really go with work, because you actually had to walk to the synagogue to go to Sabbath. So one rabbi would say, well, the reasonable interpretation of the law is, yes, you may go to the Sabbath. You may exert the physical exercise to go to the Sabbath. Whereas the next rabbi says, well, wait a minute, you got to come home too. So you're allowed to go there and to come back. So that's the amount of physical exercise you can have on the Sabbath. So the point is that even the law, there was different interpretations, and every rabbi was a little bit different about how best to live out the Torah. That was called the rabbi's yoke. And so when you as a young man wanted to become a rabbi's disciple, you were wanting to take on the rabbi's yoke, so you can learn and become just like the rabbi. So these kids would go to the rabbi and they would apply, and the rabbi would begin to ask, do you have what it takes to be my disciple? Are you the best of the best? Have you memorized the entire Old Testament? You know, but if you think that that person didn't have it, you'd send them home. And you'd say, you know what? Good try, but go do the family business. I appreciate the effort, but you just don't have quite what it takes. Go home and do the family trade. But those, the best of the best that were able to keep going level to level, they would actually, the rabbi would say, you can be my disciple. And what would they do? They would leave their family. They would leave their friends. They would leave their synagogue, their community. And they would devote their entire life to learning what that rabbi did and how they lived. That's what it was meant to follow in biblical times. That's what it meant to be a disciple, to really believe. And they had a phrase, it said, may you be covered in the dust of your rabbi. Meaning you followed so closely, you did what that rabbi did, that when they're walking, leading you through the dusty terrain, that the dust that would be kicked up from their sandals, you're following so close that you would be covered with the dust of your rabbi. You followed so closely. It was a high honor to be a disciple. Every parent wanted to raise their young man to be a rabbi. It was a high honor. So I take you to our text here this morning. Look at verse 16. As Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon, who'd later become Peter, and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake, for they were what? They were what? Well, why were they fishermen? Because they didn't make the cut. There was some rabbi that at one time said, you know, nice try, but you just better go home and do the family business. I think your dad's a fisherman. He's got a good business. You know, you just didn't quite do it here. Go home and do the family business. So, Jesus is calling people to be his disciples who were the rejects, who were the losers, who were the ones who didn't graduate. They didn't meet the standards. Jesus is so amazing. He does things so differently. I mean, think about it. If you want to build a successful business, or you're going to look for sharp people, people that can do the job, that are qualified. But here, Jesus chooses people who didn't meet those standards. I kind of relate to this, because growing up, I was one of five. I was the youngest, four older sisters. My oldest sister was kind of like my hero growing up. She was a great athlete. In high school, every sport she excelled in. She took their high school girls basketball team to the state finals. Just great success. She went on to play in college at the University of Wisconsin in Stevens Point. And there she became Woman Athlete of the Year. And here I'm younger, I'm coming up through the ranks of the school that she just left, and every coach is saying, oh, there's another hammer coming. Wow, I bet you're going to be good at basketball just like your sister. And in my heart, I did. Now, as a young man here today, you may have an older brother that you want to be like, or maybe a sister. You know, I wanted to be like my sister. And so, you know, coming up, I couldn't wait to try out for the basketball team. And so tryouts finally come, and I'm there, and coach is like, all right, I'm expecting big things from you, Hammer. And so I'm all excited about it, and I try out. And I thought I did pretty well, but, you know, as tryouts go, and you already know where this story is going, don't you? Well, he says, come back tomorrow, and posted on my door will be those who make the team. Of course, I come back the next day so excited, and I look, Daryl Gehring, Tim Jacobs, John Schultz, who were kind of about the same, and his name was the last name on the list. Mine wasn't there. I got cut. I didn't even make the JV team. Man, I went out to my car. I was just bawling like a little baby because I thought, oh, I'm going to disappoint my sister. You know, I just... Even myself, you know, I loved it so much. I wanted, you know, and you laugh because I know you've been there in some team sport or something. Maybe you got cut, or maybe you got passed over for a promotion. Maybe he chose her instead of you. Always the bridesmaid, never the bride. We have all experienced that to some degree, and maybe we didn't make the cut, and so here, these guys that Jesus was choosing were guys that didn't make the cut. And that's what makes what Jesus did here so amazing. And even for us now. You see, Jesus, remember we read a couple weeks ago that Jesus was baptized by John. He begins to walk by people and choose them to be his disciples. People who weren't even qualified to be a disciple. They barely made it past the first level. And not only did he chose Simon and Andrew, but look, once he said, come and follow me, I will make you fishers of men, it says at once they left their nets and followed him. That seems awful irresponsible, doesn't it? To leave your job? But see, back then it was an honor. And so it says in verse 19 that he went on a little further. He saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John in a boat. They were fishermen too. And without delay, Jesus called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat. Now, what do you think Zebedee thought? Here he built this family business. He was raising his sons and family to take it over. And all of a sudden, this guy in a robe comes by. And they drop everything and they go follow this rabbi. But see, in Zebedee's mind, his dream finally came true. And this wasn't an ordinary rabbi. This was like the rabbi of all rabbis. A miracle worker. Somebody who taught with authority. Just, he was so different than anybody else. So for us to look and read that and say, I don't get it. Some guy just walks up to them and they leave everything. But in that culture, that was like, wow, the highest honor. And the people that Jesus chose were people that didn't make the cut. And because of that, it swings wide open the door for all of us. When I read this week, I came up with three things. I didn't know what to call them, so I called them three somethings. Three important somethings. Maybe three takeaways, if you would. And think about this is 2,000 years later than when it actually happened. Here we're still talking about this guy of such great influence. The first one is this. The first something is this. Jesus sees something in you that you may not even see in yourself. Jesus sees something in you that you might not even see in yourself. I mean, as I said, to be chosen to be a disciple in that day, it was a high honor. It meant you were spiritually adept. You already demonstrated commitment. But Jesus changed all that when he asked the 12, who are, the Bible says, unschooled, ordinary men, and even the hundreds of other disciples that followed him, what did they feel? They were the rejects too. To say, you know what, we're going to follow you. So I tell you this morning, he sees something in you that maybe you don't even see in yourself. I mean, think about it. They still smelled like fish. They weren't wearing maybe the appropriate clothes of a young rabbi in training. They probably weren't even that smart. They had one oar in the water and one oar out of the water. I don't know. They didn't have it all together. They probably had forgotten most of what they had memorized at the first level of education. But see, he sees the same thing in you regardless of your past, regardless of how inadequate you feel to follow Jesus. He's inviting you to follow him. You are following something. You're following somebody. Everybody follows something. You're following a certain mentality, train of thought, based on how you're raised and how to do relationships and how you do your marriage. You're following a certain set of ideals. You're following something. You're following someone. How well do you follow Christ? Whose disciple are you? Who are you mimicking? What and who are your children following? Think about that for a moment, parents. Who are they becoming a disciple of? So what could that possibly mean for us today? Now, for most, we read that and say, okay, well, if that is what it biblically it means to follow Jesus, to drop your nets, then tomorrow morning I'm going to walk into my job with my resignation letter. And I'm going to go to Africa. Follow Jesus, wherever. That's not what he means by that. But it could mean that maybe you need to leave some of the immoral or ungodly practices at work. Or maybe some of the attitudes you have in the workplace that are less than becoming as a witness for Jesus Christ. Maybe it's leaving some of those things. Maybe it doesn't mean that you're going to leave your family, leave your marriage, leave your community like they did as they were wanting to be that, become that rabbi. But maybe it's leaving the way you do family, the way you do marriage, the way you do relationships, because it's not healthy, it's not productive, it's not leading you in a healthy direction. So maybe it's about leaving those things. Maybe it's leaving your former ways of doing life, the mindsets, the ways of thinking, certain relationship patterns that you need to leave behind. You see, if you want to follow Christ, you're going to have to leave everything behind. You're going to have to find Christ's way, his kingdom way of living life and doing things. You can't do it both. And it's a process. It's a journey. But the big problem is this. Unless you're willing to leave something, you can't go to the next something this morning. Second something is this. Not the first one is Jesus sees something in you that maybe you don't see in yourself. Second is this. Jesus wants to make you into something that you're not. He wants to make you into something that you're not. What did he say to these men? He said, I will make you into fishers of fish. No, they knew how to do that. They were good at that. They had a successful business that supported their families. But Jesus said, I'm going to make you into something you're not. A fisher of men. I know the spiritual leaders, the other rabbis, they don't think you're qualified. You got cut, but I do. Because I see something in you that maybe you don't see in yourself. And I want to make you into something that you're not. Don't get wrapped up around the axle about what you're not. Isn't it ironic that Jesus accepts you as you are and me as I am, but he doesn't want us to stay that way? He wants to make us into something we're not. And in order to do that, you got to leave that behind. They had to leave their old trade to learn a new one. And that's the invitation that Jesus gives all of us. He wants to make us into something we're not. But our problem is we're full of excuses. But this. But what about my past? But what about that? You know, some people are just full of buts. You've heard me say this before. You'll never go anywhere leading your life by your butt. You got to leave your butts behind. Sometimes we're just a room full of butts. You know, but I can't do this, but I can't do that, but this happened to me, but that happened to me. You have to leave all of that behind if you want to follow. It's a terrible thing to lead your life by your butt. You won't get anywhere. But I'm too old. There's no way I could do what Eric is doing. I'm too entrenched in my career or what I'm doing. You know, I can't change at this stage in my life. I'm too far in debt. But I'm not qualified. But I have ADD. I can't have a successful marriage. I can't, you know, I can't just relate to people in a right way. I have a job for so long, and then, you know, I wear out my welcome because I'm all over the place. But all these kind of buts that we have. But I'm divorced. I'm damaged goods. Who will ever want me? But you know, you can lead your life by your butts, or you can lead your life by what God thinks, because He thinks something more of you than maybe you think of yourself, and even whatever you've gone through. Because God says this, I have plans for you. And it's a plan to prosper you, to not to harm you, to give you hope, to give you a future. That's my plan for you. Would you come into alignment? Would you quit following your past? Would you quit following people in your past that have hurt you? Are you really going to let some idiot in your past still influence your present and your future? Are you really going to do that? As the song says, be free in Jesus. You can be free. He'll heal you. He'll help you. It doesn't happen all at once. You know, He doesn't give us more to do. You know, it's a process. It's a journey. But believe me, His plans for you go way beyond some of the people that have restricted you, limited you, violated you, hurt you in your past. But you have to reach the point where you hear Jesus calling you and saying, I want to make you into something, and where you say, you know what? I'm done with that. I'm leaving all that behind. And you let it go. Because that's the big problem. You won't be able to follow. You'll get stuck. You'll get stuck at salvation. You'll give your heart to Christ, but you won't go much further than that because you still got this rope attached to things in your past. You're dragging them along with you. And until you drop those nets, you drop everything. And you begin to follow Jesus and His plans. Jesus' plans are great for you. He says, I've come to give you life. Not a life of depression. Not a life of anxiety. Not a life of just always just feeling like everybody else, good things happen to them. A life of defeat. He says, I've come to give you life and life to the full. Is He kidding? Is He making a promise that He's not going to deliver on? I think the problem is with us. We just want to keep carrying this junk and baggage with us into our relationships, into our marriage, thinking, well, we'll figure this thing out. We'll sort it out. We'll talk to so-and-so counselor or whatever. When really it's up to us to say, I want to follow you, and I'm going to leave everything behind, and we drop it. Are you willing to learn a new trade? Are you willing to do a way of doing life differently? I'm so glad that Jesus has been doing that in mine, that He's been making me into something I'm not. And I know Connie benefits from it. My girls benefit from it. Well, there's a third something, and I'll close with this morning. Not only is Jesus sees something in you that you may not see in yourself, and not only does Jesus want to make you into something that you're not, but there's something powerful about a small group. it kind of came out of left field for me this week when I thought of what was happening here in Jesus, in the context of Jesus. What he did right away in his ministry is he modeled small group life by choosing a group of 12 to be in his inner circle. I mean, look, that's the first thing he did. Before he held a citywide healing crusade, before he sat on the mountain and preached to thousands and fed 5,000, before he did all these incredible miracles, what did Jesus model for us? He got a group around him. He got a bunch of guys together. And he modeled the power that there is in a small group. And he modeled and demonstrated the kingdom of God, the way to live the kingdom of God out. You know, I've learned in my life that the best growth happens in a small group setting where you sit in a circle instead of sitting in rows. Where you're not sitting alone, but you're with other people. Where there's someone in your life who will chase you down when you're going off track. When they see something in your life, they have the courage and the guts to say, hey, listen, I haven't seen you in church for a while. Or, boy, you've been spending a lot of time with so-and-so. Man, do you always drink that much after work? You know, have you been, you're spending a lot of time on the internet? Man, I see your face buried in your phone. We just don't talk anymore. I mean, is there somebody in your life who you're accountable to, who can ask you those tough questions? Where you have a group of friends. Just Wednesday night, a bunch of us met at somebody's house and we're starting this hunter small group or outdoorsman small group. There are 9 of us that got together. Just, you know, I don't know what it's really going to be other than we're going to get together, we're going to pray, we're going to read some scripture and then do a lot of fun things together. I'm going to learn how to shoot one of these long rifles at 1,000 yards and hit the target. These guys are going to teach me how to do that. I mean, that's going to be fun. But we all 9 of us left that house after spending, a couple hours together excited. We're like, this is going to be awesome. You know, we're going to build relationship out of fun stuff that we have common interest in. There's a powerful thing that happens in a small group where there's a place where you can actually say, you know, listen, my wife and I, we're really struggling. Or you can say, you know, I'm so afraid. My husband has cancer. You know, I got this thing happening at work and I just don't know what to do. I could really use some advice. Are you going to continue to be the Lone Ranger? Or are you going to surround yourself with other men who are going through stuff too or other women and you're not just going to commiserate together. It's going to be centered around God, His Word, and fellowship and prayer. But see, even in a church like this size, you can slip through the cracks. You might not even get a call for several weeks if you miss. And you can begin to feel like, you know, nobody cares. But it's in a small group where you begin to feel a sense of belonging. When you arrive at church and you see people that you know, that you really know. You have people that you can sit down with and have a cup of coffee with. People that really care. You know, it's one thing to finally schedule an appointment with the pastor about your marriage. And of course I'm going to ask you, so, you know, how's your marriage? I mean, you expect me to ask you that. But when one of your friends asks you about your marriage, hey, have you guys had a date night recently? You know, have you had that difficult conversation with your teenager? I mean, when one of your friends asks you that, it just kind of, it's the nudge you need to say, you know what, I need to follow in Jesus' footsteps and be a part of a group and learn what it is to work together, work at something that's bigger than myself. Ladies, wouldn't it be nice to know that if your husband ran off, there'd be 5 guys chasing after him? That's worth it right there, isn't it? Jesus modeled the power of being in a group. We'll talk more about that in the near future as we're trying to retool our small group ministry and our connect groups and We've got a number of groups that meet. Summer's a little bit less because of vacations and all those kind of things, but you know, kind of keep your ears and eyes open for different groups that are available for you to be a part of and for you to join. But I think of when one tiny snowflake falls, it's fragile, it really doesn't impact us at all, does it? But when billions of snowflakes fall together, it can halt a city. It can close down airports. It can close down roads. And that's what happens when we understand the power of being together in a group with accountability and somebody who really cares and knows who you are, and you get a chance to know who them are. And that's what Jesus did. He grouped the disciples together, and they were able to change the world. And thousands of years later, thousands of miles, we're talking about this great rabbi who got a bunch of guys around him, and they changed the world. I want to be a church where we are covered in the dust of our rabbi Jesus, where we follow him so closely, we know him so well, that we're willing to let go of our former way of doing things, our former way of thinking, and we're ready just to follow him in his ways. And in the next several months, as we continue in the Gospel of Mark, it's going to be great because we are going to be walking in Jesus' footsteps. We're going to be understanding Jesus' way of demonstrating the kingdom of God. Isn't that going to be wonderful? Instead of just relying on what we think or what we have come to know and experience in life, we're going to be covered in the dust of not just a great rabbi, but our Savior, Jesus. Jesus takes ordinary people, he makes them into something they're not, and together we can impact. We can impact our families, our workplace, Dillsburg, everywhere and around the world. Amen? And he's calling you. You can be one of his disciples. Some of you feel like, I don't measure up. I'm not good enough. I've done all this kind of stuff. Jesus has demonstrated that he's not looking for people who make the cut. He's looking for people who might feel, you know, I feel like I've kind of missed it. I've done some things. I've got circumstances now because of bad decision. I don't know if I could ever get out of this hole. You're a perfect candidate for Jesus. I'm a perfect candidate for Jesus. I haven't arrived. I fail in my life, in my marriage, and with my daughters. I don't always have the right attitude. But Jesus doesn't say, well, sorry, why don't you go back and go to the family trade? Go back to the farm in South Dakota. No, he's letting me, come on, keep going, kid. I'm going to cheer you on, and you're going to do this. And he calls all of us. He said, what I want you to do now is go and make disciples of all nations. Make disciples, teaching them to obey all that I've commanded. The one thing Jesus asks us to do is to make disciples. But you got to be a disciple first. Are you following him? Leave your everything behind and follow him. Amen. Why don't you stand with me this morning? We're going to sing a song and then we're going to be dismissed. But I would hate to miss an opportunity where you feel like the Spirit of God has spoken to your heart and you know that you're tied on to some things, you're in bondage to some things. You're entangled in some things. And you're taking this thing around wherever you go. It's like an anchor. It just goes with you everywhere you go. Into your marriage, school, with your friends. And you just keep taking it with you everywhere you go. It's your past. It's all that you can't do. It's baggage. It's hurt. Wounds that you still can't get over. And it infects every part of your life. And you'd say, Pastor Mike, I haven't let go of everything. I can think of something specifically in my mind that I need to today drop the rope and let it go. And when you do that, you'll begin to be healed. And you'll begin to understand, you'll be able to see where you're going. It's a lot lighter going without carrying all that stuff. And you're going to move from where you are and allowing Him to make you into something that He wants you to be. You'll be on that path. So as we sing this song today in our closing moments, if you say, Pastor Mike, I really need to lay something at the altar. I need to drop that rope. I want you to come from where you are this morning. You can come now if you would. You know beyond a shadow of doubt, there's something I need to lay down. I want you to come now, right now. Let's go ahead and sing this song and make your way now.